friends, welcome to this session. Literary journey, manifold streams. May I request Sitaushu Ji, Sitaushu Vaishchandra, and E. V. Ramakrishnan, please come to the dais. We have two senior writers here who will be in conversation. Of course, they do not need any introduction, I am sure, but yet, as a formality and the necessity of this session, I will briefly introduce to you Professor Sitaushu Vaishchandra, who is a national figure, one of the foremost writers of India, is a renowned poet. Besides, he is equally good playwright and also a critic and essayist. So, a manifold writer. I welcome you, sir, to this session. And we have E. V. Ramakrishnan. We fondly call him EVR. And EVR is a nationally known critic, but he is a poet in his own right. He writes, he's a bilingual poet. He writes in Malayalam, his mother tongue, also in English. So we have two very valuable speakers here at this GAF session. And now I request E. V. Ramakrishnan to please take over the mic and continue with the conversation. Thank you.
Thank you, Damodar, for your very generous introductions. This session is titled Literary Journeys, Manifold Streams. And we have Sitaushu, whose journey was as a poet, as a literary historian, as a commentator, as a dramatist. It has been quite spectacular. He is one of the finest poets writing in Gujarati today. I would actually begin with asking about, there is usually a foundational movement when a writer actually enters a literature of a particular language. There was a transition in Gujarati literature from Umashankar Joshi to Suresh Joshi. The late 50s, early 60s was a time of great transition. And as a poet located in Bombay at that point in time, he was exposed to multiple influences. He speaks good Marathi. He actually was influenced by Western modernist poets. So, Sitaushu's own journey began at a point where Indian literatures were in turmoil. This I know across languages. This was a time of great transition. Could you actually tell us something about that foundational movement which also frames your early poems?
So many poets were seated here right for me and beside me. Know of this transition. Each one of us who speak about it slightly differently, or even more differently. So, what are the metaphors that come to our mind when we think of this transition that we have all experienced? And of course, there are young people seated here to whom our collective experience could possibly relate. The metaphor that comes to my mind is we are that of monotheism and polytheism. I'm bilkul Bahudevvadi. I like many gods. What? If you are one god, then you do exactly what he or she wants you to do. If you have many gods, you could play one against the other. that's what we enjoy doing. There are so many gods, there are so many temples of poets. Medieval poets, modern poets, European poets, African poets, Japanese, this and that, Gujarati, not Gujarati, Bengali, and so on. And I go on discovering these deities. That is the fun. I'm not trivializing them, only manipulating them. And power has to be manipulated by the poet. Power has to be manipulated. That is the business of the court. So, in our own times here, I tend to become younger when I'm with you. I know that you are slightly younger to me, but so our kind of dreams and my feelings, our feelings. So, what were the forces? We are getting to know the European writers. So that was one thing. Baudelaire and Mallarmé and so on. And Rilke and so on. Very often one would not know, really in the early years, who belonged to which country. It's a kind of a big non-English world. So, and gradually then one would know more of their culture, more of their context. So also the Japanese. So through our journeys are also strange journeys. Because you come to Japan through Ezra Pound. There's no way of going to Japan. But images in Ezra Pound. And then you think of Japan. So these are the strange ways in which we have grown. But we must turn every stumbling block into a stepping stone. And we just be happy and so on. So I think that
in fact, there is a comment by Amiya Dev that the Indian poets used the Western modernism in a way to turn away from certain kind of Indian situation. This happens in Bangla, this happens. The question I am actually raising is, how do you actually play your own relation with, there was something oppositional in this entire journey. The questioning, interrogating, at the same time, at some point, this also became a quest for one's own native roots. In Marathi, one actually sees a nativist movement emerging. In your own poetry, you moved, you had these surrealist poems, you see, initially. At some point, you turned towards the medieval Gujarati tradition. Jadayu actually is a poem in a very powerful poem which actually uses the resources of tradition again in a very contemporary sense. How do you actually look at that transition, your moment?
I think there are some poets who are largely public. There are some poets who are largely private. I belong to the second category. So the social concerns and political concerns and so on, initially they were not my concerns. Trying to really, what can I say? For example, the very first versification I did, much longer before I even attempted writing poetry. But it was something I still remember, I still enjoy that moment. My father died when I was just 5 years old. And later on when I grew up, earlier I didn't miss him. But later on I sort of missed him. So my first versification was a quarrel against my father. In Gujarati, it's a chandas, metric. I didn't know how to write meters. I thought poetry is written like in meters. So, but what was I doing with the meters was something else. Something very private, rather than public. So I said, why did you die so quickly? Why did you die so early? You know, there was a quarrel with an absence. Now culture very often is concerned with the presence. What is present? You want things to be present. I think poetry is not all about culture. Poetry is not all about, you know, kind of downtrodden or women and the range and so on. No problem. As I said, there are two types of poets. So, but my journey is a different journey. I felt an absence, and I was quarreling with that absence. Father was there and gone, and not that I didn't know that. And to whom was that addressed? Strange question. And that's why the early poems are surrealistic, because they deal with that which is not present at the level of awareness. So that kind of thing. This is a stream of Indian poetry which many of the contemporary Indian poets who were rooted there, they sort of, you know, they are quickly trying to merge with the public poetry. So there is, and there is no strict division between the public and the private. I mean, you live in a semiotic web. Your meaning is produced only with connections. But at which point do you enter that web? That is a question. And I enter that web from myself rather than from my society.
You have also done a whole lot of discursive writing. I remember your essay from Narasimha Mehta to Hind Swaraj on Gujarati literary culture. You have also worked for Saitya Academy on an encyclopedia. How do you actually, do you see this regional Indian kind of writing? I have a serious problem when people say a writer writing in Indian English is an Indian writer, but someone who writes in Bengali or Malayalam or Oriya becomes a regional writer. There is a serious problem here. I would call somebody like Bashir or Anandamurthy or Ramashankar Joshi an Indian writer, you see, who writes in one particular language. So this issue of regional national kind of opposition, very often it also leads to a certain invisibility of very fine writers who are writing in Indian languages. We need to actually know, very often these writers take up issues which are much more cosmopolitan than actually issues which are addressed by English writers in India. We have a recent Malayalam novel which is entirely located in Bengal. There have been a whole lot of, there was another novel which was about Gulf life. Almost entire Marquez actually is translated into Malayalam. A lot of people think Marquez is a Malayali. So that's the kind of situation we are in Kerala. So we need to actually look at this context. And how do you respond to this?
This is a conversation. So you don't have the sole right of asking questions. And I'm equally interested, all of us are equally interested in what EVR thinks of this, because it's something very dear to him. Multilingual person, Malayali, living in Gujarat for a long time, author of English, turning towards Indian literatures. This is also a very interesting journey, and I reserve my right to ask you questions. So what? What do you think, EVR, of this? As they say, Bhasha Kavi, as if English people are non-Bhasha. They are also writing. This marginalization of...
No, they are English and we are language.
So, Ilya, what do you think of that?
I feel like it's largely a false kind of binary. In fact, writers writing in English cannot be blamed, because English occupies a certain kind of power structure, a domain of power, because of colonial kind of history. And we need to actually know that increasingly Indian writers are trying to move away from that kind of preoccupation. I would actually like to add, I've been an English teacher, in fact, lot of Indian writers writing in Indian languages who have changed the sensibility have been teachers of English, including Anandamurthy, Ayyappa Panikkar, Buddhadev Bose. You will find a long list of them. they all had the, some of them never wrote in English, they all confined themselves to in their languages. So in that sense, English has opened up possibilities. And I would also personally, commenting on my journey, at some point I started asking this question. I taught English in Marathwada, one very backward region, quote unquote. Now it's changed in the 70s. Then I moved to Gujarat. And my classes used to be multilingual. And students used to come from all kinds of social classes. What am I doing by teaching English? My answer is fine. You say, I am teaching English. But I was not happy with that question. What are you doing when you teach English in India? And this took me towards greater dialogue with Marathi department, Hindi department. In our institution, the barriers between these languages are extremely forbidding. I never enter into a dialogue with regional language the teacher, but I found they have so much to give me. Early 70s was the time when Marathi literature was changing radically. And I met a lot of Dalit writers. I understood the kind of churning that was happening. And I understood the classroom also need to be responsive to the situations of this kind. And that is where I began translating, and I also writing on Indian literature increasingly in English. So all these for me are not, they are a kind of seamless activity. Writing poetry in English, translating poetry from Malayalam, Marathi or Gujarati, or writing about poetry, all actually in a way takes me towards a space which will liberate me. And that space of liberation, a space where dialogue can happen, I feel I've been saying in many places, we are actually a nation of strangers. There is hardly any dialogue between Malayalam writers and Tamil writers, Marathi or Gujarati writers, or Urdu and Hindi writers. Unfortunately, in this country, if you do not talk across boundaries, and we also actually understand what others are doing, we will not discover ourselves. Maybe this dialogues need to actually happen not in a structural, highly structured way, but in an informal, creative manner. And many Gujarati writers that way who are located in Bombay, Bombay is a place where 8 or 9 languages flourishing. There are Malayalam writers, Bengali, and I know there are Kannada writers, some of them very famous. But sometimes they don't come on a common platform. We need to have this kind of platforms in India. This kind of, so I do very strongly feel Indian languages, including English for all its creative potential has become, now Indian English writers are not writing for a foreign audience. And there is, and the kind of translations happening, Mini Krishna is here, those translations are also not meant for foreign audience. So 40 years back, it was impossible for me to do a kind of doctoral thesis on Indian literature. Now it has become impossible for a lot of students to do doctoral thesis on English literature. Indian literature is increasingly the topic in English departments. Yes. In the last 40 years, a whole lot of things have changed in the right direction. And in the 70s and early 80s, the kind of self-doubt, self-kind of questioning I was actually doing in a very remote place in India, now I find answers in the kind of the situation emerging.
That is it. So we have to find out in which way our journeys are parallel, in which way they are divergent. That is kind of Indian literary community, and Indian, the community of Indian readers is emerging and would emerge. So, Subodh is right here. You are right here. So, I was wondering, what happened to me from this very private origin of poetry? Later on, what happened? See, when you are pursuing that elusive person called yourself, then things happen. If you are honest, then things happen. Then you realize that as time passes, how you change. It's like that boat of the Greek philosophy in which planks are changed. And at one stage, all the planks are changing. Is it the same boat or is it another boat? So as time passes, now Dilip and I are like in our mid-70s. So that is how one explores the world in which we live. Fear and love drive us. That's what happened to me. There are such easy comments on political and economic events. Someone else speaks your voice as a poet to make that comment. Indira Gandhi is like that, Nehru is like that, Narendra Modi is like that, Morarji Pillai is like, of course nobody remembers, though he was Prime Minister from Gujarat. So very often they ask me about Narendra Modi, I said, why don't you ask me a question about Morarji Pillai also? But questions are not, they are imposed on me and the answers are built in. No one asks an honest questions. The answers are built in. And the poets are supposed to, open that built-in answer. Now I refuse to do that. And so I'm going to read a poem which would tell you how, it's a longish poem, about 8 minutes. So, but it would tell you how I moved from these early poems of surrealism and so on to Jatayu, which is a kind of myth and so on. First was also a myth, Odysseus. So, but it's a shorthand, myth is always a shorthand or something. But later on, I wrote a poem, which is a crazy kind of poem. And I have sufficient number of crazy people before sitting before me. So let me really read. I have written some poems which are called Gujarati Kavita. Now this is my challenge to the rest of India and the rest of the world. In the sense that you have a notion of Gujarat and Gujarati poetry. Or probably you have no notion. But if you have some notion, it's such a kind of a businessman and not sufficiently engaged and so on. It's not so. Gujarati poetry, Gujarati poets are sufficiently engaged in everything. A person like me would start from some point but reach somewhere else where, and I would find Shubhosh sitting there. So this is a poem on Ibrahim Rugova. When we grew up, Nehru, Nasser and Tito were very big names.
Yeah.
The young people wouldn't even know their names, but they were very big names. And they were the non-aligned nation, non-aligned world. And we really prided in that. Independent, non-aligned, neither Russia nor America kind of thing. When Tito died, Yugoslavia broke and balkanization of an entity which was put together. I got interested in that. Because if it happens to Tito's nation today, it might happen to Nehru's nation tomorrow, so to say. So, I have written a poem on Ibrahim Rugova and I call it Ibrahim Rugova Mate Gujarati Kavita. And this Gujarati Kavita has its own innuendos. So, after Tito died in 1980, balkanization took place and in 1990 there was genocide between three groups. One was a Muslim group, one was a Eastern Catholic, and the third was simple Catholic. And they were killing each other. Croatia, Bosnia-Herzegovina, Serbia, Kosovo, Macedonia, Montenegro, they all divided. They were killing each other. At that time, Ibrahim Rugova, though he was in a Sunni majority Kosovo, he had a different kind of vision of living together. Not like Tito, but like Ibrahim Beaubois himself. He was trained at Sorbonne, he was a Sorbonne painter. I also taught at Sorbonne. So I this also there. So this is the, and there were Slobodan leader Milosevic, Croat leader Tijman, and Kosovo Liberation Army, and NATO stepped in, Russia, America stepped in, and they had a peace conference. They were invited, this man, Ibrahim Beaubois, who was elected majority leader, but he was not invited to the peace conference. He was kind of marginalized because they wanted to divide the place. So, Ibrahim Beaubois mate Gujarati Kavita. This is a political one. As we write in Kokani or any language, of something happens to our language though, through all this violence. Our language is mutilated. So I've written this poem, look at a mutilated Gujarati language, which has lots of English and lots of other languages, Persian Arabic also is there, and you will see the fun and, you know, the absurdity of this poem, which I hope you will enjoy. Ibrahim Beaubois mate Gujarati. It doesn't use Gujarati in its own, it uses sounds of violence. Katal is katra, is butchery in Persian Arabic. And we use that word in Gujarat, katal karinari, katra. And sabra is, sabra rakhna means have some patience. Sabra, katla, these are words which we use in Gujarati, but they are from Persian Arabic. We have changed them a little bit. Instead of sabra, we say sabra, katal, and so on. But, so the language. Let me read this poem. Ibrahim Beaubois mate Gujarati Kavita. Katla bha, dik, bomb, laksh, laksh, gha, katla, hana, hana, dik, nikandana, kandana, grun, bruna, grana, vrana, vrana, hana, hinsra, hinsra, hana, jakva, krosavo, kandana, kandana, posavara, katla, kampa, sarva, alme, nikandana, kona, kona, savara, go, slow, slow, bodana, go, slow, go, slow, go, slow, katla, hijvata, tarva, vrana, vrana, grun, grun, slow, boda, slow, bo, sli, sni, ya, harza, govina, hana, mess, Macedonia, camp, ke, mess, go slow, harza, go, nato, chit, krosa, war, tuch, man, grun, na, toto, me, la, so, which, Ibrahim, him, which him? Which? Sarva. Sabra. Which him? Me, no, so which? Which? Ru, gupchupja. This is a Gujarati word. Varu, varu, gupchupja. Okay, goes quietly. Varu, gupchupja. Go, sarva, sabra. Sabrahim, rugova. Dieton, kosavar, varamvar, tito, to, tito, varamvar, dasra, nasra, javahar, tim. Do you know? No. Nukandana, twendana, all a bride, hijarat, harza, vina, go, all a bride, all a tight, all a might, it. Slav, Slavia, go, Yugoslavia, go, Yugoslavia, vina, harz hai, go, Croat, nit, Nikandana, Croatia, Serbia, sabra, art, Sir, Toto, na piso, Toto, nato, ro, Gujarati, Rugo, Varu, Jara, Roti, Uja Rova Sabra 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 Jina Ibrahim Jina Rom Jina 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 Hana Jina Hana Chit 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 Kar Chit Kar Chit Kara Chit Kar An Pan Pangu Pangu Jarata Panjava Panja Pancha Av Char Av Trana Av Be Av Be Av Avaru Be Avaru Goa E Kan Avaru Nawab Juna 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 Gad Gad Chit Kara Chit Kar Av Av Na Av Av is water Av Av Na Av Av Tarasa Tarasa Sos Sos Bum 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 bunga bunga bungag bungag ab ag ab ag a lo qua khali a go wa nawa khali a katla katla han han sin 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 dikkar dikkar chitkar kosawa refuge na na agru rubaru 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 kem kem re Refugee Vavado Re Refugee Vavado Chu Jina Jivado Katala Lia Katala Lia Katalia Lia Katalia Kem Kem Re Be 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 La Gra Gra Be Be La Gam Game Gam Dava Khana Go 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 Dhara Go Dhara Ti Krandana Krandana Vada Amada Vada Amada Da Vada 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 Dava Khana Dava Khana Loa Khala Khana Khana Nikandana Krandana Kash Kashmir Kashmir Refugee Babu Jibu Gujarati Jibabu Hijarati Hijaratu Tabu Valkana Balkana Balkana Jibari Balkana Jibari is a Kachi word means the playground for the children. It's somewhat like Kindergarten. Tutabu Balkan Ji Bari, Nasala Bari, Amara Bari, Balkan Ji Bari, Tomar, Ba 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 Pu, Ba Ba Pu, Ba 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 Pu, Ba Ba Pu, Ba Ba Gandhi 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 These are the kind of crazy poems that we all like to write. How can it compete with this great Indo-American, Indo, or how to say, Indo-English writers who are so clever with marketplace? They know the marketplace, they know the readers. So what they do is ultimately these people who write on certain subjects and certain market and all the publishers who are around them, what they do is they rob the reader of their creativity. That's what all of us are fighting against.
Shall we open up other questions from the audience to Ladri to Siddhamshu? We can actually open up, otherwise we'll... if there are questions, we will pause. Yes.
It's a small thing. You made a statement about situation in Mumbai where there are several languages and there is no communication. I think it should be a little more informed. Lots of us are meeting in Mumbai, not very often, but still. That makes very little difference. Malayali poets, Bengali poets, Tamil poets, Gujarati, Urdu, Sindhi, we are meeting and there is a communication. And you also have been part of this kind of invitation earlier.
I do know certain things are happening, but considering the large number of, if you look at a cosmopolitan metropolis like Bombay, it's not happening to the extent I see cities like San Francisco and several. There are a whole lot of other cultural forums. We do not, in the last 20, 30 years, we have not created such very intense cultural forums. And I also very strongly feel translation and translation is also now picking up in terms of publication. But in our institutional kind of situation, translation is not getting that kind of, translation is still some kind of an activity which is considered inferior compared to creativity. These are, of course, issues which are related. I would also ask, because Siddhamshi has been very close to a large number of writers across boundaries. He actually has, our own Mauzo, a whole lot of, he has been associated with Sci-Fi Academy. How do he actually value this kind of relationships? And how do they help us? Very often, it's not just knowing a person. It's knowing a whole lot of, when I travel to a place called North Lakhimpur and meet a lot of people, I see how a small part of Assam is very close, in many ways very similar to Kerala. You see, these journeys are important, since one of the issues here is literary journeys. I would include this kind of knowing other cultures, writers, part of literary journeys. I would like to your comments on this.
So much is happening. Janashri Mafri, Rati Saxena is here, Hindi speaking, a student of Ayappa Padikkal, and bringing together everybody. And lots of, so non-commercial gatherings like this, non-sensational gatherings like this, Amar Dari is here, Karuna, and we take a stand together in Sahitya Academy, if you remember, how we get together and take some standing. So these are the, we have to fight battles together. Community of Indian readers and Indian writers would take place when they fight some battles together. These need not be political battles. In fact, it's best that they are not political battles. There are other areas. We are all passionate about our languages. I'll carry this book so fondly with me. I've carried this book so fondly. So this is how I will keep in touch with Kokani. But what are the, very briefly, I opened this topic up, passing through crisis together. So what is the crisis? What are the different crises that confront us jointly, not as Gujarati or Kokani writer? So what are these questions? So understanding, crisis of understanding. What is happening is that we are taught too much now. There are all sorts of classes which are going on around us, all sorts of teachers. Political leaders are of course the most innocent of the teachers. Clever teachers are the corporates, and several other religious also, they are also equally foolish. We can see them through. But this corporate, the leaders of the economic world, they are the most difficult. And they have captured language. They pay much more for advertisement agencies than for poetry. Huge amount is paid for writing jingles.
Yes.
And for writing poetry, nothing. See, this is what is happening. Corporate world, their use of money, and their use of our languages. Terrible. They are such absurd jingles in Gujarati, and they have paid so much for it. Now from jingles, they have come to these festivals. There are two types of festivals, like this, or like what Rati is doing, and some others. And there are other tamashas. See what is happening. So this is the battle we have to fight together. Battle of intelligence. Battle of understanding, battle of how we are manipulated at the level of language, and how our own people are manipulated in the language at the level of our mother tongues, and so on. So these are the various ideas I would like to place before this extraordinary gathering.
So both have a question?
Yeah, I have a question. It's it's good that it's a battle, but now think about this battle at a different level. I was recently in the US and in Europe. I was giving readings of my poems. It again happened to me, and it has been happening to you because you have been in the US and Europe for so many years. You taught there, you have a lot of experiences. The battle is that when I finish reading my poems, somebody just stood up from the audience and questioned, "Are you Dalit from India? Or are you writing in English?" Only these two questions I have faced, you know, everywhere. So now even it's not only in the US or Europe. So even people here are asking me, even at Goa Festival, at Calcutta Festival, at Delhi Festival. So India is only for Dalit writers or English writers. What is happening to other 24 languages and many others? And we are so rich in our own languages. But why people, even you look at the media, I have been strictly following the newspapers for the last 2 days. Is the focus either on political things, the focus on national politics, or it's somebody who is not that much important in Indian literature but has entered into it as literary agent or something like that, and capturing everything. This is the market space, as you have already referred to. This market space has already been occupied by them. So what is happening? How do you react to this? You have already reacted to this battle. It's another part of this battle I have talked about.
See, what is happening is we are crossing the political boundaries of India through our work. In a very quiet way. Abhay is seated quietly somewhere there. And he spoke yesterday of diplomacy. So he distinguished the politician and the diplomat. Rajapurush, as they say. Rajapurush. And he's like that. So quiet and so unassuming and so on. So like this, Sukosh, I think we are gathering, slowly gathering kind of a larger army. That is kind of Republic of Letters, as was said earlier so many times by so many. But a larger sisterhood or brotherhood, larger sorority, larger fraternity. And then, because the political and economic forces are also quite internationalized now. So what do we do? But when we invite, or when we are invited, see the point, who is a poet? I mean, that is ultimately the question. What is poetry? Who is a poet? These are the issues also you must look up. There are so many mandah kaviyasha prarthi gamishyam upahasyata, Kalidas says. Even if Kalidas has this sense of saying that I'm a fool, I'm a foolish person, mandah kaviyasha prarthi, I want the fame as a poet. There are some people who even want money as a poet. But those who don't want money as a poet, location is the last ishara. Kirti ki ichha, wo bahut galat. I think that is what is stopping me. I mean, really introspect myself. And me also. And best of my friends. It is location. If that is given up, then we'll have a power which will unite us with such people who are genuinely committed to producing a word on a page, So that is a word that we are, only we are doing, and that is the Vak Vyapar. In a recent editorial, very briefly, before Rati asked a question, I used the word Vak Vyapar in two senses. In Sanskrit, as you know, Vak Vyapar is the process of language. But vyapar is also business.
Yes.
From one kind of vyapar, we have come into another kind of vyapar. He also selling, and he must stop that. And
yes,
really live alone.
I just want to go back because I want to
ask. Be brief. Maybe we are running out of time.
Just go back. Because when you are talking about, for both, I'm just asking, when you are talking about the communication between the poets, what problem I face in Hindi, what I'm looking from the distance, I'm looking in the Hindi poetry in contemporary world, that maybe the one reason poets, or like Delhi poets, they are, because they have so much communication between themselves, so they are copying each other. And from distance only you can find out that they are writing the same. If you remove their name, you don't find out that who has written this poetry. And one Estonian poet, I think you know this, Mathura, he told me that Naresh Saxena's poetry, he said he's writing, he's copying the Kurna, right? So because from distance he could find out. I think too much communication is also, is not good for poetry.
It's an
enemy of the poetry. That's what I want to say.
That's everyone knows that. You're right.
Thank you, Riti, for that comment. At best, poetry is a minor art, and poets form a minority. One Malayalam poet actually calls it Savarna Pratipaksham, a kind of golden opposition party. You see, so long as the poets voice the oppositional, voice strongly, register it in a society, there is hope for that society. Bertolt Brecht says, they will not ask what politicians did. They will ask, why were poets silent? So let's not be silent, and
yeah.
Thanks to Kovali.
Voice. Finding a voice.
Thank you, Stoji. Thank you, Ivia, for the wonderful session. Thanks for giving us your valuable time and sharing your.